resources has evolved massively over the years, and we have come up to very recent techniques which are being employed quite extensively, and you would have heard from the previous speakers also about it. In addition to that, the techniques which evolved earlier before this are also very much in use. So all of these techniques comprise what we call as genomics of today, and these are being used for managing plant genetic resources, starting right from the use of molecular markers to the use of GBS techniques such as sequencing by genotyping, genotyping by sequencing techniques. So I'll be talking starting from the beginning till the updated most techniques and touching on each of them so that you get an overview of what all is there available in the basket, in the genomic basket for exploitation or utilization of plant genetic resources. So there are five major institutes in India under the umbrella of ICR which are involved in management of genetic resources, and this is NBPGR where you are presently right now for the management of plant genetic resources. Then you have NBFGR for the management of fish genetic resources, NBAGR in Karnal, management of animal genetic resources, NBAIM which is the agriculturally important microorganisms, and NBAII for insects. So all of these, though the commodities are different, the organisms are different, are involved with collection, characterization, evaluation, conservation, exchange, registration, and in facilitation of utilization of each of the genetic resources which they work with, right? So plant genetic resources, you are here for the past few days and you know now the importance of plant genetic resources, and it was Vavilov and co-workers who were the first ones to realize the importance of crop diversity for genetic improvement. So they were the ones, though starting from the time of Darwin we are aware of how important diversity is, but it was Vavilov who emphasized on how crop plant diversity or crop diversity is plays a very important role in improving the genetic background or genetics for crop improvement is requires plant crop diversity. Okay, so what do we know as plant genetic resources? They represent plants or parts of plants which are capable of generative or vegetative propagation with actual or potential value, including land races, wild relatives, and special genetic stocks. So you would have heard of this by now. So these include cultivated varieties, obsolete cultivars, primitive cultivars, wild and weedy species, and special genetic stocks. Why is it important to us? Because out of 3 out of the 34 hotspots of biodiversity are there in India, which are the Himalayas, the Indo-Burma region, and the Western Ghats in Sri Lanka. Now, this is just an introduction. This is the management of plant genetic resources as given by Maxted in 1997. And this shows that starting from selection of target taxa, you should have conservation objectives. You go and collect the diversity which is required through field exploration and collection. And you have got different conservation and storage strategies, ex situ, in situ. You conserve accessions, and then what? Then you need to characterize them and evaluate them so that you can use them in breeding, during breeding, and using biotechnological techniques so that the final byproduct is either new cultivars or pharmaceuticals, depending on what you're working with. So it is here that in characterization and evaluation and utilization mainly, that we are using the genomic tools to assist us. So these are the major areas where we are using the genomic tools. Now coming to genomics. The term genome was coined by the German botanist Hans Karl Albert Winkler in 1926. So since then we know a genome, and he referred to the genome as a haploid chromosome set of an organism, right? That is when we first came to know of what is a genome, and this includes the chloroplast and the mitochondrial genomes also, right? The term genomics was coined by Tom Roderick in 1986, and this refers to the study of the genome, and it is an interdisciplinary field which targets on structure, function, evolution, mapping, and editing of genome. So as you can see, it's a vast, vast area which covers almost everything with which DNA and its downstream processes are involved with. We usually talk of genetics. So how is genetics and genomics, what is the borderline between them? When we talk of genetics, it is the study of heredity, that is the study of inheritance of characters from one generation through another, and the basic unit is the gene. Whereas when we talk of genomics, we are talking of the study of the entirety of the organism's genes, and that is through the haploid chromosome set, including the plastid and the chloroplast, as I just said, and the mitochondria. So the genome could either be the DNA or RNA, as in the case of RNA viruses. It is contained in the nucleus. It is arranged in chromosomes, as we well know, two copies of each, for example, in the diploid organisms. And as we say that there is a very minute difference in the genomes, for example, human to chimps is a very small difference. The DNA is very long, so it is packaged in the form of nucleomes. And these are the things which we are studying. As we see, the chromosome number varies from 1 in bacteria to 46 in humans. But when we talk of the genome size, and here we are talking of the genome size in bases. So as you can see over here, there is a huge difference. For example, grape, it is 483 megabases. And wheat, it is almost 16,000 megabases. So there is a large variation across organisms for the genome size. Excuse me. Now coming to the omics, we are now living in the omics era, and we say that genomics is the study of genomes, as I just told you. Proteomics is the study of protein structure and function. Metabolomics is the study of primary, secondary metabolites in the plant. Transcriptomics is the study of RNA across different tissue types, different stage that is associated with the expression. Bioinformatics is an application of computational and statistic algorithms and tools for the management and interpretation of biological information. And phenomics, we say, is high throughput, high dimensional phenotyping. So you would have come across these terms some way or the other. And the prerequisite of all of this is sequence information. So you need sequence information of DNA, RNA, and protein. But what before this? Before we had sequencing, was there no genomics? Was there no biotechnology? No, that is not so. It is before the sequencing era came in, we had markers. And what is a marker? We talk of markers. A marker is just simply something that serves to mark. That marker could be a morphological marker. A morphological marker is something which is discernible by your eye. It could be the flower color, grain color, presence or absence of on, right? We have a genetic marker. A genetic marker is a DNA sequence with a known physical location on the chromosome. A biochemical marker, any biochemical compound such as an antigen, antibody, an enzyme or a hormone that is sufficiently altered in a particular state that helps in diagnosing a particular condition. For example, whenever you go to a clinical laboratory to have your blood tests, it is the biochemical markers which are primarily used to find out the level of different enzymes in your blood, right? And then you have a molecular marker. A molecular marker is a DNA sequence that can be used to identify an individual or a species, right? Now, it was the first time that Sir Alec Jeffries talked about DNA fingerprints. As each individual has got a fingerprint, which is on our thumb and fingers, the DNA fingerprint of each individual is also very unique. And it was in 1985 that Sir Alec Jeffries talked about individual specific fingerprints of human DNA. So he reported the use of VNTRs, which are variable number of tandem repeats, for use in identifying individuals. And his papers came out in Nature, which was individual specific fingerprints of human DNA and positive identification of an immigration test case using human DNA fingerprints. So since then, we have been using these DNA-based markers extensively in all of our studies. Now, with that introduction, I come to molecular markers in PGR management. So these are, how do we get molecular markers? Molecular markers are essentially generated by the techniques that are based on the inherent natural variability that is present across individuals. So it is something which is already there, and we are just using tools of molecular biology to bring out this variation in the form of something which we can see, right? So the techniques which generate molecular markers are either hybridization based, polymerase chain reaction based, or sequencing based. And these are the three principles on which these are based, and they rely on the variability in the restriction enzyme sites, the variability in the primer binding sites, and for changes in the base sequences. So this is a very simple basis on which we generate molecular markers, and these have been exploited in different ways by different people, hence generating different techniques which give us the different molecular markers which we are so commonly using. Coming to RFLP, or restriction fragment length polymorphism, this is based on the technique of Southern blotting, which was given by Sir E.M. Southern in 1975. The technique which he gave was Southern blotting was a technique of permanently immobilizing single-stranded DNA on a solid support. And that technique is used for generating markers by the name of RFLP, which is restriction fragment length polymorphism, right? So we know that the differences in the DNA sequences at the restriction enzyme site will either result in gain, loss, or relocation of the restriction enzyme site. And depending on the whether it's an insertion, then you'll have a longer fragment across two individuals. If it's a deletion, then you'll have a stronger, or if it's a loss of a restriction enzyme site, then automatically the size which goes to the next between two restriction enzyme sites, if one is lost, then it is, instead of 1 in 2, 1 in 3 restriction enzyme site, which generates a fragment. And it is this fragment which we are detecting for and calling it polymorphic, right? The technique is very popularly by Botstein et al. The Journal of Human Genetics, construction of a genetic linkage map in man using RFLP. Was the paper that came out which popularized this technique. And as I said, you have chromosomal DNA, you cleave it with restriction enzymes, you get DNA fragments, you separate these fragments by agrogel electrophoresis. Till now you're not labeling the DNA in any way, and then you separate them in an agrogel. You denature the DNA so that it gets easily transferred onto the nitrocellulose membrane. You incubate with the probe. Now this probe is the DNA which is radioactively labeled or labeled with a fluorescently labeled, so that you can detect differences. Now in a gel, if you have, you will not be able to differentiate one fragment from another, but once it goes and hybridizes to a fragment that is complementary to it, you can find out across accessions, since I'm talking of plants, how the restriction enzyme site across around that probe changed by virtue of seeing a different signal on your autoradiogram, right? Coming to polymerase chain reaction, so now we are talking of PCR-based techniques. PCR was invented by Carey Mullis in 1983, and he was working for a company called Acetus Corporation, and he, 1992, he received a bonus of $10,000 from Acetus for this particular technique. Whereas in 1992, Acetus sold the patent for PCR to tagged DNA polymerase to Hoffman La Roche for $300 million. So that is the strength of his technique. And one of his quotes says that sometimes a good idea comes to you when you're not looking for it, through an improbable combination of coincidence, naivety, and lucky mistakes. So there is this beautiful paper where Carey Mullis describes how he came upon the idea of polymerase chain reaction as he was driving down the mountainside and the road was winding, and he thought of the winding road in terms of DNA, how it unwinds. So if you can, I'll give you the reference after this. It's a beautiful reading. As to some, just driving down the road, he got this idea of how a PCR reaction will work. Unfortunately, Carey Mullis died recently on August 13 this year. And but a great man, and something, a technique which he has given is something which we can't think of doing molecular biology without this technique now. Somewhere or the other, PCR comes up, right? So PCR-based DNA fingerprinting methods are what we have heard of, RAPD, random amplified polymorphic DNA, which was given by Williams et al. So there are three techniques which came in the same journal in 1990 in nucleic acids research: RAPD, APPCR, arbitrary prime PCR, and DNA amplification fingerprinting, which was by Welsh and McClelland and Catania and Aulis et al. But now we hear more and more of RAPD rather than hearing of the other two techniques, though they came in the same time. And the reason is the ease of techniques in terms of detection. So APPCR and DAF use radioactivity or phage for phage and radioactivity for detection and silver staining, whereas RAPD uses ethidium bromide. And you run this on an agarose gel, right? So running on an agarose gel and detection by means of ethidium bromide was something so simple to do over the other two techniques that people adapted more and more to RAPD, and they used more and more of RAPD in these reactions. So we see how techniques evolve and how they are utilized. All of these are dominant marker systems, right? So we score them either for a presence or an absence of a band. So this is REPD or APPCR. You have arbitrary primers. For example, in REPD, you have got Decamer primers, which you're using for amplification of the target sequence. Now, these will amplify the regions between the primer binding sites, providing the primer binding sites are present in the opposite orientation. That is very important, yes, because we know that tagged DNA polymerase will amplify it from the 5' prime to the 3' prime end. So both the primer binding sites should have their 3' prime end towards the region which is to be amplified. Then polymorphism is detected due to mutations in the primer binding site. And you analyze the products by agarose gel electrophoresis, and you score it by virtue of presence and absence of a band. So it's a dominant marker system. It is quick and simple. Sequence information is not required. You can simultaneously screen a large number of loci. So this is a multi-locus marker technique. At one point, with one primer, you are amplifying a large number of markers from a large number of loci, right? And you require a very small amount of DNA. Automation is possible. The only drawbacks of these techniques are, this technique is that amplification is performed under low stringency because the primer is a small primer. So the annealing temperature of the primer is low. So the chances that it will go and bind to non-specific regions increases. So the stringency is thereby low. And there's a problem of reproducibility. Somebody who is doing RAPD in one lab, the same kind of a profile will not get replicated in another lab. But generally, if you repeat it 2-3 times, you can score the major bands. There is unambiguous scoring in the case of some minor bands. So you have to be very careful as to which bands you are scoring in order to get unambiguous scoring. And this is a dominant marker system. So for any dominant marker system, you cannot get the alternate forms of an allele unless until you sequence and prove it to be an alternate allele, right? So this is a dominant marker system. Now coming to SSRs or simple sequence repeat or microsatellite based markers. What are microsatellites? Microsatellites are simply short DNA sequences stretches which are present in a motif of 1 to 6 bases, and these are tandemly repeated in the genome. So these are also naturally present variations. They are widely dispersed across the plant and animal genomes, and they display a high level of genetic variation based on the differences in the number of repeats. So the number of time a particular motif is repeated will vary from one individual to another. So this is at a particular locus. SSR markers, the technique was given by Litt and Lutti in 1989 in a paper in, again, in humans. They discovered a hypervariable microsatellite revealed by in vitro amplification of a dinucleotide repeat within the cardiac muscle actin gene. So as you see, all these molecular marker techniques first came out in the human system. Why? Because the need for identifying the bases of different diseases is much more higher in humans. And then they were subsequently applied to the used in the plant systems. In plants, SSRs was used by Akaya et al. In soybean, where they define the length polymorphisms of the simple sequence repeat DNA in soybean. Now, when we talk of SSRs or STMS, sequence tagged microsatellite sites, we are generally talking of them as codominant marker systems, okay? And that is where they are called as SSRs, right? SSRs are also used as dominant markers, where they are called as ISSRs, inter-simple sequence repeats, right? And this technique was given by Zikwitz et al. In 1994, where he used genome fingerprinting by simple sequence repeat anchored polymerase chain reaction amplification. So I'll just briefly touch upon this also. But generally, when we say SSRs, we mean that we are using microsatellites as dominant co-dominant markers and simple sequence repeat markers. So what is the principle behind simple sequence repeat generating polymorphism is? So you have in the microsatellite region, you have got the microsatellite locus. So here this is a dinucleotide repeat, which is CT. In individual 1, this is repeated, say, 12 times. And individual 2, this is repeated 5 times, right? And these are the flanking regions. So the regions adjoining to these we call as a flanking regions. And primers are designed, these flanking regions are conserved. So these flanking regions are conserved. Even though the number of times the repeat occurs varies, the flanking regions are conserved. And we design primers complementary to these flanking regions. So as you can see, when you amplify and when you run this on a gel, in individual 1, you get a fragment of, so this is repeated 12 times. And in addition, this is also getting amplified. So you get a larger fragment when you run it on an agarose gel. Whereas in individual 3, you get a smaller fragment, which is over here, right? So a larger fragment and a smaller fragment. And if these two were the parents, in the progeny, you would get both the bands. So you will be able to detect the heterozygous condition, which is why it is called as a codominant marker, right? So these are codominant markers, very useful for mapping studies and linkage analysis and for studying QTLs. They are used in forensics. They are used in diagnosis of human diseases, population genetics, conservation biology. Wherever you have application in addition to PGR management, the SSR markers are the markers of choice. But how do you reach the primer? So the question is, unlike RAPD markers or multi-locus markers, where you had one primer or one decamer sequence could be used in onion, in apple, in pomegranate, in mango, in brinjal. That is not so in the case of SSRs. So for SSRs, since you're designing primers, unique primers complementary to the flanking regions, you need to know the sequence of those regions. So how do you know the sequence? Because you have to design the primers, okay? So either the genome sequence is available, right? So you go to NCBI, if the genome sequence is available, there are tools which will identify the repeat regions. So for example, you have got the SSRIT tool available at www.grameen.org. And from there, you can download a sequence, go to the site, put the sequence there, find out the repeat region, go to a tool that will design primers, for example, Primer3, and get the primer sequence out. Same you can do with the transcriptome sequences. So you have EST SSRs if you've got the transcriptome sequence, and you've got genomic SSRs if it's the genomic sequence. However, if there is no sequence available, suppose you're working on a crop which is very important to India, you're working on an endangered species which is present only here, anybody else is not in the world is not yet interested in working on it, so how do you go about it? You have to construct enriched libraries. So enriched libraries are you just cut up the DNA into small pieces using a restriction enzyme or by sonication, and you ligate adapters to it, you clone it, and then you use probes complementary to the repeat sequences so that they identify the repeat sequences, so your library gets enriched. You will get only those clones which are containing the repeats. You fish them out and you sequence them. So this is called as making enriched genomic libraries, and that is one way which before the sequencing era came in was what people were doing for identifying SSR regions and designing primers for them. The other thing you can do is you can use related species. For example, I'm working on Momotica carantia, and I know primers on that. I know which primers. Somebody wants to work on Momotica dioica. He can take those primers from Momotica carantia and see whether they are amplifying in Momotica dioica or not. Okay, so that is called as cross-species amplification. So that way you can find out a list of primers which would also work in your system. And then again, for once you have identified this, you identify the repeat regions, you design the primers, and you look for size polymorphism. And these are, as I said, codominant markers. So coming to ISSRs, ISSRs are inter-simple sequence repeat markers. So whereas there you were amplifying the repeat region, the tandem repeat region, and you're looking for differences in the times the number of repeat is present across individuals as the basis of polymorphism, here it is inter-simple sequence repeat. That is, you're using the simple sequence repeat sequence itself as a primer, and you are amplifying the region between two repeats, right? And this again behaves like a multi-locus technique. It's a multi-locus technique and it's a codominant marker system. Amplification, however, amplification will occur only when these repeat regions are present in opposite orientation to each other, again as in RAPD, and they are closely spaced. If they are very far apart in the genome, then tagged DNA polymerase will be unable to amplify it, and they are inversely oriented in the genome. So these are again dominant marker systems, and they have also been used extensively. There are different variations to this. So for example, if you're just using repeat regions, they're called as unanchored primers. If you add a few bases to the 3' prime end or the 5' prime end, then they become anchored primers, and they increase the specificity of the reaction, right? So those are the two techniques just to touch upon. Now coming to AFLP. AFLP was a new technique that was given in, was a technique that was given in 1995 by Voss et al. And he called it as a new technique for DNA fingerprinting. So AFLP, or amplified fragment length polymorphism, is a technique that uses the reliability and repeatability of RFLP, and it combines it with the power and precision of PCR. So it is a combination of both. I'll just briefly touch upon it. For example, you've got your template DNA. You use restriction enzymes to cut up this template DNA. And the trick is that you're using two restriction enzymes. One is a frequent cutter, for example, EcoR1, and one is a rare cutter, for example, MSE1. Now, by virtue of changing these enzyme combinations, you can target different regions of the genome. So that gives you a handle to generate different kind of markers. That is one thing. Why are you using two enzymes? Is essentially because if you're using a frequent cutter, that will give you very small fragments, right? And they will be giving you a smear, which will be very difficult to detect. If you're using only a rare cutter, the fragments will be too long, maybe TAC will not be able to amplify it. If you use a frequent and a rare, you will get fragments of a length which are amenable to PCR amplification. That is one. And then by using two restriction enzymes, subsequently you using a primer which is complementary to the adapter, and you will be labeling the primer only for one restriction enzyme, so that when you're running the sequencing reaction will not detect doublets. So that becomes the ease of detection also, right? So what is AFLP doing is, AFLP at its subsequent steps will reduce the complexity of the genome. It will give you subsets which then you use for generating markers. So I've just talked about it. I'll just explain. You cut it with the two kinds of restriction enzymes, and you ligate adapters to it. So to one end, the EcoR1 adapter is there. You ligate that, and MSE1 adapter is ligated over there. And then you give primers. So the advantage of putting an adapter there is that once you know the sequence of the adapter, you know you can design a primer on the basis of the sequence of the adapter. So you have the primer. Now you do something called as preselective amplification. In preselective amplification, you are amplifying all those fragments which have got echo on one end and MSE on the other. Subsequent to this, you do something called as a selective amplification. In selective amplification, to the same primers, you add two or three specific bases. So as I had just told you in the case of anchored ISSRs, you are increasing the specificity so that now in the next cycle, only those fragments which have got, in addition to the primer sequence, bases complementary to those only two, three bases which you are adding to the 3' end of the primer get amplified. Once you have those, and the second trick is that here you are labeling, in the selective amplification, you are labeling the primer, EcoR1 primer, with either a radioactive moiety, which is 32P, or fluorescently labeled. And you can then separate it on a gel. So by virtue of this, you can see that you're getting a profile which will differentiate individuals. And these are again dominant marker techniques because you're using a PCR and an RFLP over here. So, okay, so that is AFLP. It's a dominant marker technique. Advantage is that you get at, by using, you know, one reaction, you're getting a large number of markers, right? You get a large number starting from around 100 to 150 markers are generated per reaction. And when you score them across individual, that number still increases, right? So that is amplified fragment length polymorphism, which was another technique very popularly used before the sequencing techniques came in. Coming to SNPs, or single nucleotide polymorphism. Now these are single base changes in the DNA at which different sequence alternatives or the alleles occur in normal individuals, in some populations, wherein the least frequent allele has got an abundance of 1% or greater, right? Again, in humans, SNPs in the exon 2 of the BCP gene was talked about by Jordan and Humphreys in 1994. And since we are talking of differences in the bases in the whole genome, we know how many bases are there. I just told you, rice we know is 430 MB genome, so 430 million trillion bases, right? Hence, it is the most abundant marker. It is the most abundant marker, which is there, is an SNP marker. And here you can see that you have a substitution in the base. For example, if I compare this, you can see over here, if these are two individuals, there's a A present instead of a G, and there's a T present instead of a C. And there, where a base is deleted, is an indel, right? So SNPs may or may not alter protein structure. We are aware of the wobble hypothesis. You're all aware of the wobble hypothesis, where you have different codon usage, which can give rise to, the same amino acids, right? So, for example, here, in this case, in this figure on the left, this is a synonymous substitution, or a silent substitution, where a change in the amino acid C, in the codon, in the base C to G is not causing a change in the amino acid. So you get leucine being produced in both the case, being synthesized in both the case, and there is no change in the protein structure and the function remains unaltered. Whereas in the sickle cell anemia, right, you're all aware of sickle cell anemia, a single base pair change, a single base change, a single nucleotide change from A to T in the gene of for beta globin causes sickle cell anemia, because you're getting a change in the amino acid that is being produced. From glutamic acid, you're getting valine, right? So you see the strength of SNPs, right? A single base change can either cause no difference at all, it becomes a silent substitution, or it can cause something as a sickle cell anemia, a major disease which affects humans, right? So that is why these are the differences which are present there in the genome, and they are also used for characterization of the germplasm in plant genetic resources. They're the most abundant molecular marker. They occur with a very high frequency, and this varies across different. For example, in maize, there is one SNP detected every 47 bases. In wheat, one SNP every 540 bases. In potato, one SNP every 21 bases. And they're found in both the coding and the non-coding regions. And so since there's so many SNPs present, how do you score them? So you score them as haplotypes. There are haplotype patterns for SNPs, and they are conserved across the genome in haplotype patterns. And any set of closely linked SNPs are inherited as a unit due to the lack of linkage, lack of recombination, right? So if you see this table, we are seeing 6 S&Ps at position 28 to 277, and these co-segregate as one of the 4 haplotypes. These are the 4 haplotypes, 1, 2, 3, 4. So these SNPs are giving rise to 4 haplotypes, where this is one pattern, this is another pattern, right? This is a, so you see that CCT, CCTC. So these 3 individuals have got the same haplotype. This individual has got a different haplotype. This is the third haplotype, where instead of the C, you have a G here now. Instead of this T, this varied between haplotype 1 and 2, right? And this is the fourth haplotype, right? So can you, is that okay? So you can see how studying the SNPs that are closely linked will give you different haplotypes, which can then be analyzed by using different computational mechanisms. So the abundance of the SNPs and the ease with which they can be measured make them very, very significant for studying genetic variations, and these are called as the third generation markers. Right? You have got, now there's something called as SNP detection and genotyping using SNPs. So these are different things. First of all, you have to know that a SNP is there, and that is called as SNP discovery. And there are different techniques to do it, which I will not be talking about, because there's a whole range of techniques which are available for SNP discovery. And there's the SNP consortium which is there, which brings out the SNPs in humans after each study and analysis. And for example, in humans, you've got that kind of a consortium where people interact and you can study these. And then there are different methods for genotyping. Once you have identified SNPs or discovered SNPs, there are assays which are generated with which you can, the assays which will help you in genotyping the SNPs when you want to study them across individuals. And these are, a SNP that is close to a particular gene will act as a marker for that gene. These are useful, very useful for creating high density genetic maps. As I just told you, changes in the protein will cause, changes in the SNP causes changes in the protein. And it is sometimes possible to correlate a SNP with a particular trait or a disease. And this is known as association genetics. So I'll just briefly touch upon this after in continuity with this. And this is what which has given rise to techniques like genome-wide association studies and genotypic by sequencing, which are the most preferably used genome sequencing based techniques which are in use now. So coming to sequencing now, since I'm talking of genome sequencing, there were 2 sequencing methods that came out, Sanger sequencing and Maxim-Gilbert sequencing, right? So Sanger sequencing is again something which is more profusely used or more commonly used over Maxim-Gilbert sequencing now. Frederick Sanger was the person who gave this technique. He got first a Nobel Prize in 1958 for determination of the structure of the proteins, a Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1980 for determination of the base sequences in nucleic acids. Okay. Now, this is the paper in PNAS, that is the Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences, USA, that came out in 1977. As you would have seen, I have taken a clip of the original papers and put them there. And you should go and do a Google search and read the basic papers. It is really very interesting to read the basic papers and see how people got around ways and the availability of things at that time and those novel ideas which came up to them. You know, now we talk very frequently of sequencing, but how they conceived the idea, what were the bases they had, and I'm sure this is something which you should really read. So DNA sequencing with chain terminating inhibitors was the paper, Sanger, Nicklin and Cowlson in PNAS 1977. And this method is based on the 2', 3' dideoxy chain termination method, right? So what do we do is that we take 4 tubes. We have the template DNA. We take 4 tubes. The dideoxy nucleotides are added separately. And wherever a dideoxy nucleotide gets incorporated, the reaction terminates. And once you separate it on a gel, you can read the gel from the shorter fragment to the larger fragment, okay, for the bases. So this will be T, A, you know, you go that way. and you get the sequence, right? So this is Sanger's method and it has got automated. Again, you are labeling. Automation is done now by using different labels for each of the dideoxy DNTP. So the same thing occurs as I have just shown over here. Chain extension and chain termination, gel electrophoresis. There's a CCD camera now that is used to detect the fluorescence, and then computational sequence analysis. Now, how this became automated is firstly by the use of these fluorescent dyes, and secondly by cycle sequencing. So you have cycle sequencing where chain termination sequencing is performed in a thermal cycler using a heat stable DNA polymerase. So you don't have to stop anywhere. One cycle of the other, the sequencing reaction continues, and you can sequence in one go around 600 to 700 bases in one time. But this has to be a purified fragment. You cannot sequence a mixture of fragments because then you will not get distinct peaks. As you can see over here, each color corresponds to each base, and you can read the sequence like this. So I have just shown an example of an autorad versus a fluorescently labeled a capillary electrophoresis run. So here we are running it on a gel, and here we are running the fragment on a capillary electrophoresis automated system. So you can compare, you can get the read. So in 1972, the nucleotide sequence of the gene coding for the bacteriophage MS2 coat protein was first given by Minju et al. And the nucleotide sequence of the bacteriophage 5X174 DNA, 5X174, was given by Sanger et al. Again in 1977. So starting from there is no stopping now. From sequencing, we have come to the next generation sequencing techniques, right? So going a step further, I'll just go by the timeline. 1953, we have discovery of DNA structure. Then 1973, the first sequence of 24 bases was published. 1977, we have the Sanger sequencing method. Then 83, we have development of PCR. First automated sequencer, the applied biosystem PRISM 373, as it was called, came up in 1987. Okay, the capillary sequencer ABI 310 came in 1996, and after this you will see, after automated sequencing came up, it greatly accelerated the genome sequencing projects across the world, right? So you have sequencing of the Caenorhabditis elegans in 1998, 2000 human genome was sequenced, and after that, starting 2005 to even now, we have got a lot of next generation sequencing systems which have come up. Now, what is the difference between Sanger sequencing and next generation sequencing, right? When we talk of next generation sequencing, there are four basic features of it. It is cost effective, it is fast, it is ultra high throughput, it is cloning free, and you are sequencing very short reads and then you are assembling them together. In Sanger sequencing, the concept of assembling sequences was not there. Now, you would have heard a lot of names which are, or if you go through papers, you will see a lot of names such as Illumina, Pacific Biosciences, Helicos, Nanopore, Roche, right? These are all sequencing platforms. These are all different companies which have come up with their own sequencing machines, and they keep on bringing forward different models. For example, Illumina had a genetic analyzer 1 which came up. Okay, now we have got more recent versions which give you high throughput. So starting from there, GA2 to now, different models have come up which have increased the efficiency, have increased the output, and decreased the cost. So that is a major advantage, that the sequencing cost has now come down very low. So what is this next generation sequencing? If you compare Sanger sequencing with the next generation sequencing technologies, then you have, in Sanger sequencing, we had to have a single PCR purified or cloned fragment which underwent dideoxy sequencing reaction, capillary electrophoresis, since you're talking of an automated system now, and you have a sequence readout, you have one read per sample, right? In next generation sequencing, what you're doing is you're making genomic libraries. So this is called as a shotgun approach, right? You have a DNA fragment, you fragment the DNA into small fragments, you ligate adapters to it, and you then use these fragments. This is called as a sequencing library. So this is an example of an Illumina system where on the Illumina flow cell, you're using this for generating clusters of the same fragment by binding to the flow cell, and it is these that you are sequencing. And these are not more than 100 to 150 base pairs depending on the system you are using. So once you have this, then you get the sequencing data. You align it or you assemble it. So short fragments of 100 base pairs are assembled, and then you get your longer fragments, and by mapping them onto a reference sequence, right? So this is how next generation sequencing technologies differ from Sanger sequencing. So there you had clones or PCR amplicons, you have DNA libraries here. There you can have many samples because each sample is a PCR reaction. There you have few samples, but you can per run, but you can multiplex the samples. This is easier to do. There are a few sequencing reactions and a cleanup. That is a very complex procedure. There are subsequent steps. So starting from your DNA to your sequencing data, getting your sequence reads, there are a multiple of steps. And the advantage is that you get thousands and millions of reads per sample. Okay? So that is where we come to NGS. The different platforms which came up for next generation sequencing were initially the 454 sequencing or the Roche sequencing, as it is called. And they had two systems, the GS Junior and the GS Flex system. Then Illumina, they give the Solex or the Solexa, the HiSeq system, the Genome Analyzer 2, the MySeq, and now you have the Extend system. Applied Biosystems also, the Solid system. Then you had IonTorrent, which is the personal genome machine. And then these were the next generation or the amplified single molecule sequenced technologies because they were using an amplification step. Now we have the third generation sequencing or the next generation sequencing, which uses a single molecule sequencing. And these are PacBio, Pacific Biosciences, and Oxford Nanopore. So they give you longer read lengths. So nowadays, when you're doing sequencing of genomes, we use a hybrid approach, which is you're using long length as well as short length reads to assemble the genome. So a hybrid approach is what is being used. Now I have talked about SNPs, I have talked about sequencing, talked about next generation sequencing on how you can generate a huge amount of data, and this data can be used for detecting SNPs. So then comes the technique of GBS, that is genotyping by sequencing. And this came up, the paper in 2011, Elshire et al. You can see the number of citations to that paper is 2,272, number of views that are there. And it is a robust, simple genotyping by sequencing approach for high diversity species. So essentially, this technique came up for diversity analysis using SNPs, which are generated on the basis of next generation sequencing techniques, right? So I've just cut and paste the clip from the paper itself, the abstract. It says, here we report a procedure for constructing GBS or genotyping by sequencing libraries based on reducing genome complexity with restriction enzymes. This approach is regions of the genomes can be avoided. So the advantages of the technique are highlighted in the abstract itself. So they're using methylation sensitive restriction enzymes, they're avoiding repetitive regions of the genome, can be avoided, and lower copy regions targeted with 2 or 3-fold higher efficiency. This tremendously simplifies computationally challenging alignment problems in species with high levels of genetic diversity. So, with the coming of NGS technology, we need bioinformatics more and more, because you need more and more algorithms, more and more computation, because you're dealing with so much of data in one experiment. So, GBS is a method to discover SNPs to perform genotyping studies, in short, right? And these are the different steps, whereas you have a library preparation, you're cutting it with an enzyme, for example, APE1 is an enzyme which you use. Then you're putting barcodes by virtue of different primers. Once you have those, you are sequencing it. And when you sequence individuals, you are doing something. After that, you get the data. You do SNP calling, which is requires a lot of computational energy. And then you can get different SNP reads, which are there, and these are used for diversity analysis. So genome-wide association studies is another application, which the paper itself says, Brachi et al. In 2001, genome-wide association studies in plants, the missing heritability is in the field. So this is such a beautiful topic for this paper which came out, where we are not banking on making mapping populations. We are not dependent on finding variability across two individuals and then studying their inheritance, but the field itself is having the heritability which you want to study, and so jivas, the missing heritability is in the field. So jivas is a hypothesis-free method for identifying associations between genetic regions, that is the loci and the traits, right? So what you typically do in a jivas experiment is you find out the common variants in a number of individuals, both with or without a common trait, and using SNP arrays. So you're finding the differences in the SNPs across the individuals. Then the variations or the variants associated with the disease or within the same haplotype. So I just talked about haplotypes also. As a variant associated with the disease will be found at a higher frequency than in the case of controls. So you have got the controls and you have got the diseased ones, and then you do statistical analysis to indicate how likely a variant is to be associated with a particular trait. So these are very detailed topics. I mean, given the time, I'm just touching upon these, because if anybody was to just talk on this, it is a whole lecture on its own. So these are the brief basic things which I'm providing to you, and if you're interested, you can read. The references are also there, right? For example, you have got the cases and the controls. And this diagram, it shows the identification of the alternative variants in the case of, in these two examples, where you get the variant with higher frequency in the cases than in the control, and then you can subject to statistical analysis. This is what an output finally looks like, and assign a p-value to each variant, and then associate a particular SNP with a particular trait depending on the p-value, right? So jivas is something which we are doing for diversity analysis in a lot of, especially in relation to the gene bank, where we know that we have got a lot of variability conserved in the gene bank. It is not possible to have mapping populations. We have got the diversity panel available, and doing jivas on the basis of SNP assays is a very lucrative idea to harness all this diversity which is present there. So coming to the end of the lecture, we have DNA genotyping and sequencing thus as integral components of for conservation of PGRs. And as you have seen how each of the techniques has given its own contribution in this evolving field of the application of genomics in the conservation of PGRs. And you can see here that starting from collection to the final utilization, as you can see over here, you have germplasm collection, you have an ex situ collection, Then from there you can identify unique germplasm, reach to core and mini cores by reducing the genetic redundancy which is there using the molecular techniques. Once you have there, phenotyping along with genotyping and sequencing, they both complement each other. You do need phenotyping in order to associate a particular trait to a particular molecular marker. You have trait mapping and allele mining, and you can use this in plant breeding. And from here itself, through pre-breeding approaches, again, it has got an application. It goes back to germplasm exchange also, and you can improve the yield quality. You can study the biotic stresses, abiotic stresses, climate resilience and whatnot, depending on whatever is your objective, using genomic tools and applying them on the plant genetic resources. So that's it. Thank you.